My name is Ben Holt. I'm the past chair of the Vancouver Linux Users Group. We're a community-run organization of over 800 people that's formed to support and advocate on behalf of Vancouver's Linux and open source software users. We welcome the opportunity to work with the city to explore its transition to open data, open standards, and open source. I'm here today to convey two messages. First, I'd like to assure you that open source software is very well supported, and that moving to open source software is by no means going it alone. Open source software is supported by large multinationals such as IBM and Novell, and by smaller local firms. Vancouver has a very capable, professional, and experienced open source development community. We're here to help the city. Second, I'd like to speak to the open data portion of the motion. Not only is this an excellent idea for all the reasons outlined in the motion, but also because hidden in the city's data are an untold number of treasures. To illustrate this point, in 2000, the Vancouver-based Goldcorp Mining Company did the previously unheard of and unthinkable and released all of their exploration data for the Red Lake gold mine in Ontario. At the time, gold prices were low and the mine was becoming uneconomical. Inspired by the open source development model, the company released their data and created a contest around finding new drill targets. As a direct result of opening their data, the Red Lake mine went from producing 53,000 ounces per year of gold at a cost of $360 per ounce to producing 504,000 ounces at a cost of only $59 per ounce. Almost 10 times the volume at 1/6 of cost per ounce. Clearly, opening the mine's data the wider community paid off for Goldcorp. Releasing the city's data may not result in the streets being paved in gold, but information nuggets will be found and the city will benefit as a result, as will the local community. Thank you for this opportunity to present to you.
Thank you very much. No gold in our streets.
Not yet.
The next speaker is William McGrath.
Pursuit of this truth will be transformation. Openness belongs in government. It is the essence of democracy and accountability. Thank you, Councillor Ryan. So, information is culture. Our birthright, the sea in which our hearts, minds, and souls swim. But what of the ethics of that culture and the software that creates it? Two competing value systems exist, one of community and one of commons. It's simply a question of who is in control, public or private interest. Commercial software concerns seek to privatize our culture and the means of creating and accessing it, even to the extent of creating monopolies and eliminating competition. Community software is the result of massive collaboration between ordinary volunteers, independent organizations, and ethically oriented corporations and governments. Many hands make light work. And community software is the future solution to our global technology problems. The future, the difference is one of openness, of sharing, and more than that, of protecting users' freedoms, protecting their choices, and their right and ability to access their culture. In practice, community software seeks to be both free as in price, and free as in freedom. Freedom should be essential, but freedom is pivotal. Commercial interests generally do not respect freedom. For example, my freedom of speech allows me to exchange letters with anyone in the world. But if I try to send my letter electronically, the recipient must also be using compatible software. If my friend uses different software, we cannot communicate. Manufacturers think nothing of restricting our freedom of speech by using proprietary file formats as a kind of corporate weapon to create, expand, exploit, and enforce brand loyalties and suppress competition by locking other vendors out of the market. The solution to this sort of problem is interoperability. Interoperability is about eliminating prejudice, discrimination, and favoritism to create a true barrier-free software space. Everyone is familiar with the .html files found on the internet. Any computer can access a website and read those files. That is interoperability. A level playing field open to all equally. The question of interoperability comes down to file formats. What are file formats? File formats are ways of specifying how data gets stored. I'm sure you're all aware of the Dewey Decimal as well as the Library of Congress cataloging systems. They simply use different specifications to store information, much like different file formats. Proprietary file formats are controlled by private interests. They're often used as corporate weapons to corner a market and enforce a monopoly. The idea is to tilt the playing field in their favor rather than cooperate with other manufacturers and use common file formats. In the technical world, this kind of public standardization is long established in many fields. When control is shared, then interoperability ensues. It's based upon open public standards accessible to anyone, and most importantly, peer-reviewed by an independent agency. Problems and conflicts can be resolved cooperatively and openly. Any manufacturer is free to opt into such standards and compete fairly. The fact that they don't and insist upon secret proprietary standards and adopt anti-collaborative business practices is indicative of a private agenda that seeks to corner the market. Open markets work better than monopolies. About 5 years ago, the state of Massachusetts decided to implement open file formats for its data storage. Microsoft opposed this initiative in the strongest possible terms, and a David versus Goliath political bloodbath ensued. So I'm tabling an excellent reference document that thoroughly analyzes the issues surrounding file formats as understood in that conflict. Should Vancouver face similar opposition, hopefully we'll be smart enough to learn from Massachusetts. The real challenges we will face will be in implementing our new policy. We will require committed, knowledgeable support staff and the will and dedication to make this work. In conclusion, a policy of openness will require us to establish an interoperable software ecology within Vancouver government. Interoperability requires independently reviewed, publicly accessible formats and will help create an environment of fair competition and shareable information. Our culture is our birthright, and we should protect our ethical software communities from monopolistic interests. In this, Vancouver can lead the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. You have no questions, so the next speaker is James Maynard. James? No, then the next person is Scott Nelson.
Hi, folks. I've been working with technology for 30 years, odd years or so, and I've gone through my phase of working with proprietary technology, and for the last 10 years I've been working as a technology steward, working with open source, open data, and open formats. Many of you know me from my work in this area, and promoting this area. I'm here to tell you that this is a great motion. I'm really excited to see this happen. Please go forward for all the scene. And to just give you one example of a change that this will make virtually immediately, as far as I can tell, that is your video casts that are currently come off from this council chambers are actually inaccessible to many technology users. Proprietary format, and moreover, it's the licensing that you presently have around it doesn't allow anyone to take it and modify it in any way. So just by passing this motion here, people in this community would immediately feel empowered to further distribute and do that work for you. That's just one example of the changes this would make in terms of this. And I'd like to end by saying, I try and condense this down when I'm trying to help people understand this issue. And the way in which it seems to work, I haven't had anyone say, no, that's wrong, is that we can't have a free and open society based upon proprietary technology. That's as concise as you can make it. So thank you for this motion. Great work. Thanks. If you have any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Nelson. You have no questions. Next speaker is Malcolm Van Yost.
Hi.
I'm looking, Malcolm.
Sorry? That's me.
Okay.
I just want to also say thank you for the motion. I think it's awesome. I actually help organize with some of the people here the Open Web Conference, so I have a particular interest in it. I was brought into open source from just being a web developer. I didn't really know about what the whole open source thing was, the philosophy, and I've sort of come into it, from a more business orientation, and it's just, the philosophy is people working together to create something like a marketplace. An essay called The Cathedral and the Bazaar, where one of the founders of the open source movement talks about how the open source scene is like a bazaar, a marketplace, people working together to create something as opposed to a big monolithic organization. In terms of economics, I mean, I'm getting more work than I can handle working in open source, so I really think it's good for economic reasons. And the open data stuff, yeah, I guess it's a concern if you're worried about selling your data or people taking your data and reselling it. But there's different licensing that you can use. I really hope you go through with it. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Karen Fung, followed by Audrey Fu.
Volunteer for the Vancouver Public Space Network, and I'm here to convey our support for the motion, particularly with regards to open data. The Vancouver Public Space Network does advocacy, education, and outreach on matters pertaining to Vancouver's public realm. And I'll direct your attention to the letter that's being circulated with regards to more specific detail on how this would impact our work, but I would like to emphasize that making data more open has a direct impact on volunteer-run organizations in that we are able to direct our limited resources towards actually providing analysis and insight towards data rather than the mere act of securing it. And we are gratified for the support that open data will be able to provide to our organization with regards to being able to carry out our mandate in a more efficient and effective manner. Secondly, I'm with Curtis, who is a master's candidate at the School of Community and Regional Planning at the University of British Columbia. My research area has been around civic engagement and internet-enabled collaboration. So I've been firsthand witness to some of the incredible innovation that can come out of the entrepreneurial communities, both here in Vancouver as well as in Toronto, around open data. I've previously organized conferences around data around transit systems, and I can definitely say that having open data available brings a different citizen conversation to another level, and that is a level based on fact. And that enables citizens to also come up with solutions that are based upon this data. And it's a real speaking to the faith of the industriousness of the citizens in order to make this data available. And I believe it is completely central to moving towards a more sustainable city. And I look forward to working with my fellow citizens as well as city staff with regards to open data, bringing about the nuggets of valuable nuggets of information as a previous speaker. And thank you again.
Thank you. And our next speaker is Audrey Fu.
Hello. Thank you again for the opportunity to speak to council. I also want to thank my fellow Vancouverites who have spoken to the council. Quite a few of us are very strong community activists in the open source industry and have helped foster business in the community, and we're all very fired up about this issue and we're happy to be here. I want to introduce, I want to tell my personal story within the free and open source industry, which has helped me to earn a living and empower me in this community. I'm an immigrant to Canada and I have a good education as an engineer at McGill and a postgraduate from SFU. I changed into the information technology industry when it was at the lowest time during the dot-com bust. So I ended up with a tech support job at minimum wage. But participation in the free and open source community allowed me to grow in knowledge and opportunity to earn a better living. And I really love the fact that in the open source community, I allowed access to information and tools that empowered me to take my skills to a greater level. And I also gather recognition based on skill and merit and contribution to community rather than whether I'm a female or whether my cultural history or my age or any other reason. So currently I contract with a company based out of Washington, D.C. that works with open source software for federated identity, community, and search. Over the years, I've also helped contribute back to this local community by helping to organize user group meetings, technology conferences that have collaborated with people involved with speakers from Adobe, Google, Yahoo, as well as very well-known information technology groups, which Malcolm also spoke on earlier. I'm also I'm referring to the Open Web Conference that's upcoming in June. So on a personal level, as I mentioned, it gives me a little bit more hope and faith to hear about this motion, and I hope that the city fully commits to understanding the issues. It's a growing motion in the world with many industries supporting it more and more and community that's behind it. And if you guys need any help, any concerns, feel free to contact any one of us about these issues. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next speaker is Bobby, your name, please.
Thank you, Council, and thank you, fellow citizens. I just have a quick little demonstration that we wish to engage the Council in. I'm going to make use of the overhead projector. Yes, by the way, I should point out that this little netbook is running Linux. My name is Bobby Bees, as you already know, and this is just a quick demonstration of how through vendor lock-in, City Hall can inadvertently hinder the adoption of open source, alternate browsers, alternate operating systems, and alternate hardware. First, I wish to apologize up front to those who may find this presentation a little rambling. I only discovered on Tuesday, May 19th, that today's meeting would occur, and I have a very hard time putting my thoughts into concise points. And I wish to extend my apologies to the GNU FOSS open source Linux community up front. I'm really not that deep into computers, so if I appear to be trampling on certain cherished philosophies, I'm sorry. A short while ago, I tried accessing the recorded videos of a previous council meeting, and that reminds me one quick thing. Alas, unfortunately, as a Linux user, I cannot view any of these videos as the company that hosts these videos for the City of Vancouver is a Microsoft partner. The format chosen by InSync is WMV. I can purchase a legal codec package from a company called Fluendo. However, this does not include any updates if Microsoft decides to update the Windows Media Video codec at a later date. WMV is a proprietary codec from Microsoft. Most versions of the Linux operating system do not ship with required codecs installed for legal reasons, mostly relating to patent infringement and DCMA violation for reverse engineering. And there are other ethical concerns as to whether or not open source software should contain proprietary code. I will not get into the debate about proprietary codecs being included into any operating systems governed by GNU/FOSS philosophies, as these discussions are far above my head. I'm just a simple Linux user. I don't program, and I use Linux because I admire the background of this operating system. If City Council wishes to discover more about Linux, all I can do is recommend they check out wiki pages for both Linux and Linus Torvald. The YouTube videos I will be showing use the FLV codec from Adobe Systems. This codec is proprietary as well. However, Adobe has gone out of their way to make the playback codec available for almost every operating system in existence and just about every piece of hardware capable of media playback. There exists an open source video codec, but it is patent free. However, at this time, Ogg Theora becomes more widely supported, switching over entirely to Ogg Theora may not be prudent. Dual streaming in both Adobe's FLV format and Ogg Theora may be the more logical solution. So we'll get out of this. So I've got network connection, so I'm just opening up my browser right now. We'll go to the City of Vancouver webpage, and those people look familiar for some reason. We will go to the previous 2009 meetings, and we'll scroll down here, and we'll try to watch this video. So the only thing I'm going to get is a black block box in the middle of my screen that says no video. I don't have the choice to watch this type of format on this machine because the codec's not there. However, if I go to YouTube, which uses, as I said, the Adobe FLV plugin, and I scroll down, we don't want to watch that one right now. Now, the only thing we didn't try is the audio hookup. But this is a video that I uploaded yesterday, and it's just me speaking to council. It's viewable on this machine. I can view it on my cell phone. I can view it on almost any piece of hardware because Adobe hasn't used this format to try and restrict other operating systems. That's the big issue with Microsoft. Microsoft not only writes operating systems, they write the video codecs, and if they choose to put up barriers to other operating systems, they're more than free to do so. So that basically concludes. Oh, actually, one other thing. This is kind of a little sore point. If you try and go to public VanMap and try to view most of the maps on VanMap, you'll require. We'll try to start VanMap there. And oops, can't use VanMap on this machine because it's not a Microsoft browser and it can't take the Microsoft plugins that are available for it. What I can do, get out of there, I can use this little VanMap Lite, but this thing is so hideously slow and so limited as opposed to what VanMap Full would be, it's of no benefit or of use to anybody. So there we are with VanMap there. I can, through Google,
three O's.
So there's the Google map that everybody should be familiar with. Google has, I'd like to point out, runs Linux on their servers, but they're doing something different here. They're making this map, they're rendering it on their machines, not on this machine. So as I zoom in on Vancouver, keep getting closer, This is all, nothing that you're seeing is being done on this machine. It's all from Google then. So there are answers, there are ways that the city can ensure that everybody has access to the data, which I believe is part of this open source, open data format. But the city has to choose to go in that direction. They can't allow outside vendors to dictate that, you know, this is the codex, these are the plugins that you need.
Mr. Beecher, hold over time.
Sorry.
Councilor Woodsworth has a question for you.
So is this the reason why Ken tried to watch a video of the council meeting, but she has a Macintosh, couldn't look at the video?
Yes, if she doesn't have the plugins for Mac, she won't be able to watch the video.
And she'd have to spend a chunk of change in order to get those... So
yes,
software
there are codec packages available. As I said, I can buy a codec pack for this from a company called Fluendo, which would allow me to watch the Windows media. But then next year, if Windows changes the format, I've got to shell out another $25 for the new codec pack.
I wish our staff were here, but maybe they're listening. And how difficult would it be to adapt our system so that people who've got Linux or Macs or whatever can easily access at least some of this basic information?
Sadly, that's beyond my scope. That would be more of the Linux community and the free open source software community. I'm sure there's a million and one solutions. If Google can do it, if YouTube can do it, I can't see the reason why City Council can't choose a more open format. Yes, FLV is not an open format. It's proprietary, but as I alluded to earlier, Adobe has seen go bent over backwards to make this thing available. I've watched YouTube on my cell phone. I've got a little Palm Pilot to play YouTube. It's everywhere.
Maybe one of the next speakers could let you know about that. Thank you very much. This was really informative.
Thank you. Those are your questions. The next speaker is Dr. David Burgraf. Thank you, Mr. Beast.
Thank you.
Dr. David Burgraf, am I pronouncing it? Unless it's Fiona Bruce, somebody from Gelders Systems, Inc., or perhaps not. Okay.
Scott,
seeing as there's no further speakers, Councilor Reimer.
Excuse me, I should be on the list also. I was a late addition. Caitlin Sherwood.
I don't see you on here, but... sure, why don't you come on up. Is there any further people that were wanting to speak to this? No? Could you spell your name for the clerk?
K-A-I-T-L-I-N. The previous person occupying that seat did take my name down. Okay. I am a freelance, my name's Caitlin Sherwood. I'm a freelance web developer. And I'm going to show you really quick, thanks to Bobby already hooking up the machine, a site that I have done that shows information from the U.S., mostly census information, but also elections data. So here's a map of the results of the U.S. presidential election. And I will also show you really quickly what should we show? We'll show the unemployment rate on a county-by-county basis. This is not to show you how great I am. This is just to show you what types of things are possible to do. You may be saying, well, we're in Canada, and this is U.S. data that you're showing. Why do we care about that? Well, we don't, maybe. But the reason it's U.S. data is because U.S. data was freely available, and I could use it without any concern about copyright restrictions or anybody coming after me. The Canadian data is generally owned by the Crown, and it's not possible for me to do things like this. Note that this is something that I did as a hobby project. I get no revenue from this. I can't guarantee that if you make your data freely available, that I would do something with the Vancouver City data, but I can guarantee you that if you don't make it available, I will not do anything with it. And neither will the next person, or the next person, or the next person. It is only by making it freely available that these things like this can happen. That's what I came here planning to say, and there are two other things that I wanted to say as a result of hearing other people talk. The first is, I heard somebody mention a little bit of concern about support for free and open software. I'd like to tell you a quick anecdote. I was doing a project. I was painting a jacket with glyphs, with characters from all kinds of different writing systems. Lots of them. Defunct writing systems, existing writing systems, Chinese, Korean, old Elamite, Sanskrit, things you've never heard of, Blackfoot. And putting all of samples from all of the different writing systems into a spreadsheet so that I could keep track of them and have them easily available. I was using Linux, as I normally do, and I was using something called OpenOffice, and it broke. The data format got corrupted. Now, this was a very, very aggressive use of the technology. I had 400 different writing systems in that. This is not something that anyone would normally do. I complained about how it broke on my blog. Grumble, grumble, grumble. It's not quite there yet. Grumble, grumble, grumble. 3 days later, I got email from one of the developers of OpenOffice saying, can you explain to me what this bug was? I'd like to try and reproduce it. I'd like to try and fix it. I'd like to try and help. This is the reason why I think open source will win. I cannot imagine Microsoft sending me emails 3 days after complaining about a Microsoft product on my blog and having them try and work with me to resolve the problem. So that was number two. Number three, one of the council members over here, I forget who, was concerned about if we make this data available, then someone else could resell it. Well, that's perhaps possible. There are two different ways around that. One is to make sure that you publicize well where the data can be gotten for free. If I can get it for free, or if I can get it by spending $10,000, giving $10,000 to such and such company, I'm going to go get it for free. That openness and publicity is your friend in matters like this. The second possibility is to put a license on it specifying what people can and cannot do with the data. You can say, use this data as long as you say that it was from the city of Vancouver. You can use this data as long as you don't charge anybody for it. You can use this data as long as all the fonts you use are free. You can use whatever license you want. Now, I would hope that you would give an unrestricted license, meaning that I could incorporate it into a product of mine and make money that way, because that is an engine of economic growth. It's also probably economic growth that would stay in Vancouver, because the people in Austin, Texas probably don't care so much about it. And I'm over time, so thank you very much.
You have a question from Councillor Mengstone.
Yes.
Over to this side.
I was just curious about census data, because the city staff do an invaluable sort of survey of the whole city demographically using the census data. Is it available, or is it all paid charged for as well?
When I started this project, I couldn't find really any Canadian data that was freely available. Since then, there's a site called geogratis.ca, I think. If you Google geogratis, and it is a repository of graphical information system data that looks to be free and clear. It looks like I can use it. I haven't had time to go examine the licenses in great careful detail, but there's two big features that I want to implement on my maps thing, technical features, and then the third thing I want to do is to start importing Canadian data, if GeoGratis looks okay. Does that answer your question, sir?
Sounds like it, yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, Councillor Meigs. We have one more speaker, and Mr. David Eads.
Just want to make a couple of brief comments. I've been involved with the open source software for a little while now, and I care a great deal about Vancouver. I was born here and was raised here. And there's kind of three things I want to speak to about this motion. The first is, I think actually people haven't spoken that much about the economic benefits of this motion. When the notice about this motion started spreading over the internet, and got retweeted thousands upon thousands of times across the world. The one thing that was really interesting is what bloggers and Twitterers started saying was, wow, I would like to move to Vancouver. I think this is a really important point, because the people who are saying that are some of the best coders in the world. They're people who work on software. And we're in the middle of an economic crisis, where we're thinking about how can we attract the best possible talent to the city. And computer programmers and people who are, you know, creative class workers want to go work in a city where not only can they have fun working at their company, but they can have fun working on their city. And it's only if we provide them with the data that allows them to create the kind of interesting matchup that you saw today with the maps, that they are going to be able to do that. And so when they first saw this motion, that was the thing that grabbed them. They said, I want to move to the city. So I see this not just as a benefit for the city and kind of economics, and the city can save money, and that, you know, people will be able to view council meetings in lots of different formats. First and foremost for me, this is a way for us to attract some of the best and most talented people from around the world here. The second piece for me is around citizen engagement. We're not the first city to be thinking about this. The city of Toronto is already moving in this direction. Washington, D.C. is also moving in this direction. And one of the kind of really fascinating and fun things to see is, in, for example, the city of Washington, D.C., they opened up a bunch of their data. And they asked the community to create applications that would make this data useful to citizens. And there's been a number, I think 54 different applications were created. But the one that I thought was the most interesting, the one that should concern council the most, is an iPhone app that wherever you are in the city, you can open up this application, you can say, tell me about the city right here. And it will tell you within 100 meters what are all the building permits that have been created, what are all the crime stats that have occurred in that immediate vicinity. So right away, you can know everything that's happened. So you can walk out your front door and you can open this up, and right away, you can know everything that's relevant that the city knows about your immediate location. And that's the type of empowerment that I think we want to have to give to our citizens, so that they can then call you and say, well, I'm really worried about this building permit, or I'm really worried about the fact that this type of crime happened in my neighborhood. It empowers citizens to contact you and to work with you to make their communities better. And the final piece I just wanted to talk briefly about is the concerns of city staff, which I think are important. We don't want to simply unleash this upon this and create an enormous amount of work. I think we should be seeing this motion, as Councillor Chang pointed out, as an iterative process. Let's get an implementation plan, but let's also start moving right away. And I think there's a whole bunch of things that we can do immediately. The first is, there's actually a ton of data that you already share with the public. You share it through band maps, you share it on the website. The problem is, a lot of this data is functionally unusable. People can't take this data, and they can't create the interesting maps, they can't use it on the iPhone app, they can't allow fellow citizens to view and use this data in an interesting way. So we're not even necessarily talking about immediately opening up new data. Let's just take the data that we're already sharing and share it in a manner that allows people to use it. And then let's start working with people to figure out what data we do want to open up and start sharing that in a useful and compatible manner as well. So I'll stop my comments there.
Thank you. Mr. Eads, you have a question or questions from Councillor Anton?
Thank you. I guess in terms of where people live, I felt quite discouraged a while ago, because the guy who helped me with my website announced to me that he was moving to Hamilton, and I expressed quite a lot of sorrow that he was moving to Hamilton, and he said, what do you care? You've never met me anyway. He was absolutely right. I never laid eyes on him, even though he'd been helping me. So I guess I'm just wondering about the movability of people to Vancouver. It's a nice idea, but do people really move for that, or do they... I mean, the digits, the pixels, or whatever they are, the bytes move, but do the bodies move?
Yeah, I would try to encourage you to read Richard Floyd's Rise of the Third Class, in which he argues that actually, at no time in history, is geography even more important. It is true that, in theory, people can do any job from anywhere, and people have prophesied that, you know, there would be this, that people would start moving out of the countryside and do, you know, kind of working in the cities remotely. And in fact, the exact opposite has occurred. That actually people want to cluster in areas where there's excitement, where there's energy, and there's people who think and work like them. And what we're trying to do with, I think, with a motion like this is send a very strong signal to the world that that Vancouver is a place where we want people who engage in the city, who work with the city,
so
to cluster and come work here.
They might not all move to Hamilton then.
No, I think we already have a strategic advantage, so let's capitalize
on it. Even with the hockey team going there.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Anton, and thank you, Mr. Reeves.
Thank you.
Those are our speakers on the issue. Councillor Ryan.
I did actually want to ask a question of staff before we move to the debate. Well, know we talked to you for the break, and I got to admit my blood sugar was low, but I hope what I asked was that you could take a look through what provided enough latitude right now for us to move forward on implementation versus perhaps the more prescriptive elements that,
I would like to thank David Eads for noting that the city does already share a lot of its data with the public, with organizations, but it has mostly been on application or we put it up to the web. And so one of the things that looking at the various resolutions, what we'd really like to do is take it away, do the implementation plan, but acknowledge that some of these items are going to need a bit more investigation. Some of them are going to incur costs and resourcing and those kinds of things. So we can definitely put together an implementation plan, but we're going to have to come back to council for authority to probably spend some money, get some resources, and really work out what it's going to take in order to meet all of the particular items and resolutions.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you.
Okay. Councillor Anton, question for staff?
Oh, so I have a proposed amendment on the strength of what staff has said, if this is the right time.
Well,
it's not a question.
Let's leave it for questions first. If there's no further questions. No further questions of staff, then we'll launcher into the motion has been moved, and if there's an amendment, Councillor Anton?
Yeah, perhaps I could just get staff to comment on the amendment. Do you have the motion in front of you?
I do.
I'm sorry, is it Ms. Wallace?
Did you say Ms. Wallace?
So what I'm going to suggest is that the motion read, endorse the principles. Are you okay with the principles on the first page? I wasn't going to propose to change those.
Yes.
So on the second page, be it further resolved that pursuit of open data, the City of Vancouver will consider, and then, Madam Clerk, I would just change all those verbs to identifying, indexing, publishing, so that it parses correctly. But you don't need to do all that right now. The operative word is consider. In pursuit of open data, the City of Vancouver will consider, and then all of those bullet points. And then the be it finally resolved that. That the city manager be, and here's where the wording is different, requested to report back with recommendations and budget for an action plan. So in other words, what this does,
so
make sure
let's move to the amendment queue, and start talking about the cell phone. Let's get to on your first.
Thank you. The clerk has got that.
So, therefore be it resolved, all the principles stay the same in the amendment. And then the next one where it says, be it further resolved that in pursuit of open data, the City of Vancouver can consider.
Will consider.
Will consider. Okay. And then change the verbs. And then on the final paragraph, be it finally resolved that the city manager be requested to report back with an action plan and budget.
With recommendations and budget for an action plan. And that way, I think, to your point, Ms. Wallace, there's some of these that may look pretty obvious, like the first one, immediately identifying opportunities to distribute more of the data. I don't think any of us are going to argue with that. But some of the others may be a little trickier about third parties and giving things away. And I think it would be helpful to have staff recommendations on those things. So rather than us deciding today that all of these things are good, which I'm going to guess that it's going to turn out that most of them are, but that we would get your advice on the implications to the city. And also on the report back. So the report back would bring the recommendations on all of those pieces and also the budget. And some of them might be straightforward and easy to do, and some of them might be really expensive and hard to do, and you'll be able to tell us all of those things.
Exactly.
So those are my proposals for amendment, Mr. Chair. And so I don't need to speak more than that, but I'll leave it at that for the moment. I can speak to the motion.
Councillor Reimer, on the amendment.
I'm going to be against the amendment. I appreciate the intent, but I think the emotion achieves the same thing as it's written now, and I would hate for us to lose momentum now on identifying immediate opportunities to distribute more of our data, or
to not support the city archives, who are already developing a plan to digitize and freely distribute suitable archival data and are excited about this motion. So I think it sort of unnecessarily delays large parts of it moving forward in favor of the small parts that Councillor Antoine feels she's likely to approve anyway when the report comes back. So either way, we're getting a report. I would rather move ahead on the bulk of it now.
Thank you, Councillor Reimer. There are no further speakers to the amendment. Call for the vote. All those in favor of the amendment? All those opposed? Councillor Woodsworth, Councillor Reimer, Councillor Stevenson, Councillor Meigs, Jane, Chow, and Lee. The amendment fails. We're back to the main queue. Councillor Anton.
Yes, and I will speak to this, and I would ask for separation then, because I've taken as Wallace's advice on this, which is that we need to know the implications of these things before we say yes to every single one of them. And what we're doing right now is we're not, by not doing, taking the amendment, we are saying we are moving ahead on all of these. Never mind the consequences, we're definitely moving ahead on them. And never mind the cost, we are directing staff to move ahead on them. The action plan, we even talk about a budget, just how are we going to do it? And I think that there are, you can give political direction, but we have our professional staff here to offer us professional advice. And our IT staff are eminently qualified to offer us advice. So if I can just go through these, Mr. Chair, identifying opportunities to distribute more data, that's fine. The second one, I'm not going to support because I don't know the implications of that. Third one, I can't support because I don't know that. Fourth one, we're already doing. So it's just like telling the archives to do what it's already doing, which I think is an unnecessary motion. Fifth, and I must say I've heard Ms. Reimer on that one more than once, not telling staff to do what they're already doing. Ensure that data supplied are unlicensed. I don't know what that means. I don't know the implications of that, so I won't support it. And license any software application developed by the city, such as that they may be used by other municipalities without restriction. Like, that doesn't even say to them, you have to acknowledge the city or pay us if you sell it or anything. So I can't agree with that either, without getting staff advice on it. So I think that means I'll support the first one. And the rest I will not be supporting, although when staff come back with the action plan and we again see some more detail, it might be the opportunity at that time to say yes or no, but I don't think we should be giving a blank check right now on things that we as politicians actually don't know about. And as I say, we rely on our expert staff to give us expert advice. Thank you. So I will ask for separation when the time comes.
Thank you, Councillor Anton. Councillor Reimer?
Well, brief comment to Councillor Anton. First of all, I think it probably would have been more accurate to say that you as a politician don't know, but you're presupposing whether or not others of us know something about this. And in regards to the archives, the point there is not that they're doing it anyway, it's that they'd like to do it, and this would help enable them to do it. So it is reasonably important in discussions with the archives that we create an enabling framework for that. In terms of the main motion, since we're into debate on it, I don't know that I can say it much better than the motion, but because it's long, I'll try and give some summary points. I mean, we've heard from the speakers that this has a practical application. I know many of you have gotten emails. Local software developers are very excited. Academics, we've gotten letters from academics at both UBC and SFU who feel that their graduate students' time would be much better spent and analyzing and providing policy advice as opposed to doing data entry on hard copy reports that we have available. We've heard from community groups and we've received emails. Staff, so that you know, our GIS manager is an online blog talking about the opportunities that he sees that this could provide for the city. The library, the chief librarian sees this as very supportive of the direction they'd like to go, the archivist as well. And of course, much of our data is already shared in some format or another. This just helps make it a lot easier. Individual citizens, 311 is great if you know what you're looking for. They tell you where to look for it. If you don't already know what you're looking for, it's not that helpful. And I gotta say, as a counselor, I feel like a 311 service because I get many requests from citizens that could easily be answered if only they knew which report and had all of that information available. And that should be
easier for people to access, and this motion helps enable that, not immediately, but over time. I mean, this is an evolutionary process. And I think the points that Mr. Nelson made about having a free and open society on a foundation of proprietary paid software is somewhat incongruous, and I think driven home by Mr. B's demonstration. I myself am not able to watch Council TV on my own council computer because the Internet Explorer is too out of date to be able to watch our own council meetings. I think at base we needn't be fearful or uncomfortable about the public knowing what we know. And I think engaging them and allowing us to know more about what we already know is the goal and the hope of this motion. We, the private sector, there was an example that the private sector is even willing to take this step in a quite robust way. The Apps for Democracy in Washington, D.C. New Zealand next month will be releasing 250,000 pieces of data in open standard onto the internet in the hopes that their citizens and people around the world will develop these kinds of applications and help expand their reach. It does come down to a question of whether we believe we're here on behalf of the citizens or instead of the citizens. And I think it's a fine point, and the internet and online world has been something we've all struggled to kind of keep up with and get ahead of, and a big an institution that must necessarily be stable to serve citizens well. It's a very dynamic process to be involved in. But you might be interested to know, this motion itself has already been open source. The city of San Francisco called yesterday wanting to, their staff would like to bring it forward in their council, because while many of these pieces are being done in the world, there's no city doing all of them right now, and that's the framework that we'd be developing. And in the spirit of open source, perhaps San Francisco improves upon it and it moves around, and we all keep learning how to better provide a framework online and in a digitized world for citizens. So, many motions that we bring forward, we're following the lead in this case. It's a little bit, I find it more exciting, but I guess it can be a bigger step when we're actually taking the lead. But I'm very happy to bring it forward and thankful to the community who supported and helped develop the motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Armour. Just a point of clarification, because there seems to be some difference of opinion as you've noticed with what Councilor Anton has stated as part of your previous amendment. But my understanding and reading of the motion is that the final result that the city manager be tasked with developing an action plan for implementation of the above. As part of that development of action plan, they report back to council on all these various components that's been identified above. And that would be the opportunity of council to decide if in fact it's too costly or for logistical reasons, resource-wise, that we couldn't, for whatever reason that's identified by the city manager. That would be the final decision-making point. But likely, the intent of the motion is to direct staff to go about doing the work and identifying all the needs necessary in order to move forward. Is that correct?
Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you. Councillor Woodsworth?
Well, I'd like to thank Councillor Reimer for really taking us into the present. I think that this motion really does just take us into the present, and what we've got to do is pass it so we can move into the future and really be a global city, which we're supposed to be, but we aren't yet. And I think it's a good motion, it's sound. And my experience with the new city manager is she's very fiscally prudent. I'm sure she will come back with an action plan that is tied to our fiscal reality. And take into account the comments of the people who spoke today in terms of what the economic benefits the city of proceeding in this direction. So I will very enthusiastically support this motion.
Thank you, Councillor Elizabeth. Councillor Anton, your remaining amount of time is about a minute 15.
Keeping track, are you?
I am. Now you're down.
I think that if indeed the interpretation that you are putting on it, Mr. Chair, is correct, and that Councillor Woodworth is putting on it is correct, then that's fine. But I don't know why I'm so sold on the fact that I think our motions should say what we mean, not say something else. And so I'm disappointed that this one doesn't say what I gather everybody's intention is, which is that asking the city manager to go away and have a look at it and come back, because the city manager may say some of these things are just too hard, too expensive, we shouldn't do them right now. Or in fact do not even make good policy. But that's not an option here. The option is to how we move ahead. maybe, as I say, maybe they're all excellent, but I would prefer to rely on the professional staff advice on that, and I really hope that staff will be giving us all their advice and all the advice that they might have given even without the absolute direction of this motion. Thank you.
Thanks, Councillor Anton. So is it safe to assume that you have not changed your position on what you had earlier stated as what you're opposed to? Okay, so if I heard you correctly, there are two items of the motion that you are in fact in favor of. Identify immediate opportunities to distribute more of its data and develop a plan to digitize and freely distribute suitable archival data to the public, although you made the comment that staff are already doing that, but you're in favor of that one, are you?
No, I love telling staff. Okay. Keep up.
Thank you. So there's two items that you are in favor of. All those in favor of those specific two items? All those opposed? It's carried unanimously. On the remainder of the motion, all those in favor?
Sure, and I am in favor of the first part of the motion.
The first, therefore be resolved?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. And in favor of the first part of the motion, all those in favor? Opposed? It's carried unanimously. On the other components, of the remaining components of the motion. All those in favor? Opposed? Opposed by Councillor Anton. It does pass. Thank you. That is the congratulations, Councillor Reimer. And there were two components that were passed unanimously. The first, therefore, be resolved. And two boards. The next item that we have is the petty cabs and